In this video, we will create a machine learning model that can describe images using words, also known as image captioning. So till the end, you will create an interface like this, in which generating captions is as easy as clicking on this button, choosing whatever image you like, and getting the captions back. The concept of image captioning is fairly simple. You take an image and try to generate a caption that matches the gist of that image as closely as possible. Like here, the caption of this image is baseball game in large stadium with ball flying toward batter. This summarizes the entire meaning of the image in a single sentence. As humans, we have no trouble doing this, but back in 2015, image captioning was considered one of the most difficult tasks in machine learning, since it lies at the intersection between NLP and computer vision. They both have to work in coordination to make image captioning possible. Then the attention mechanism came to the rescue, which is one of the most revolutionary ideas in natural language processing. In my previous video, I have already discussed how attention is used in machine translation. And in fact, primary inspiration for the attention-based image captioning model comes from machine translation. So check out the video for more information. To explain this to you, first I have to understand it myself. That's why I went to the Google and searched for it. And to my surprise, TensorFlow's website already had a tutorial on image captioning. After I went through the entire code, I realized it was implemented by the famous show, attend and tell paper, and the model architecture is quite straightforward. You start with an image and pass it through a pre-trained ImageNet model like Inception V3, and this will output feature vectors. Inception V3 is a very large network with many convolution pooling and fully guided layers, and it has more than 78% accuracy in the ImageNet dataset. So by using Inception V3, we can take all its learning about vision and apply it to our image captioning problem. This is what we call transfer learning. And this feature vector is the final convolutional layer output of Inception V3. In code, to generate the feature vector of any image, we will first use tf.keras.application.inception-v3 to instantiate the model. Weights is equal to ImageNet will load the ImageNet weights into the Inception. And because we are not doing image classification here, we must remove the Inception's last fully connected layer by include top is equal to false. If we run this block now, it will download the model for the first time from the web. Then I will write the load image function. It will read the image from the disk, load it in the tensor format, resize it into an optimal shape, normalize the image array by dividing it by 255, and then return the loaded image back. However, in order to get the feature vector, we must pass this loaded image to Inception V3. To make this simple, we will write a getFeatureVector function that can take the path of any image, load it with the loadImg function, pass the loaded image to the Inception V3 model, and then return the image and feature vectors back. Now it's time to go to Google and search for a random image. I will take the image and upload it to the collab. I will copy the path of the image and give it to the getFeatureVector function. I will use matplotlib to display the image, and then I will print the shape of the image array and the feature vector. As you can see, the image's dimension has been resized to 299 by 299 pixels, and there are 3 channels because this is a color image, and there are feature vectors of shape 8x8 with 2048 dimensions. These feature vectors cannot be displayed because they are completely abstract, but if you look at the embedding space of feature vectors, they tend to group similar images together. This is why some people refer to feature vectors as image embeddings. The next step is to pass these feature vectors via a fully connected layer. But why is that? Because the feature vector has 2048 dimensions, we must downsample it to a lower dimension such as 256 or 512 using a fully connected layer. This will considerably boost the training speed and save you from that frustrating memory exhausted error. Now our neural networks has an active understanding of images, so we must train it to understand the text as well in order to generate captions. And because we used CNNs for images, you might have guessed that we could use recurrent neural networks for text, and you are correct. We will use RNN to generate the caption word by word. During training, we will have the corresponding captions for every image. That's why our training objective is to give the first word from the caption and the feature vector to the attention mechanism, and the output of the attention will directly go to the RNN. And the task of the RNN is to predict the next word in the caption. If the predicted next word is correct, the loss is minimal. If it is wrong, the loss is maximum. And this process of generating the next word will repeat until the end of the sentence is reached. Now you may ask, what is the attention mechanism even doing? Nice question. Attention, as the name suggests, automatically learns to focus on various regions in the image. If the next word to be predicted is dog, it will only pick the feature vector that corresponds to dog and ignore the rest of all the unnecessary features. Then these modified feature vectors will go to the RNN, which will predict the next word. The generated caption by the RNN may have some right and wrong predictions, and our training objective is to reduce the wrong ones. The first dataset that I chose is the Flickr 8K dataset, which has 8000 images and each image has 5 captions. So we will have 40,000 individual image caption pairs. The TensorFlow tutorial used Microsoft's COCO dataset, which has 82,000 images and each has at least 5 captions, which means a total of 410,000 image caption pairs. But I wanted to start slow, that's why I decided to go with the Flickr 8K dataset. Now our task is to load this data into Colab and prepare it for training. After downloading the data on Colab, you can see this data folder has an images directory that contains all 8000 images, and this caption.txt has caption for each image. To make this data training ready, we need to apply some preprocessing to both images and text. The image preprocessing step is the same as when we loaded feature vectors, so we will skip that. In text preprocessing, we need to lowercase the string, remove punctuation and extra spaces, and lastly, add start and end special token to mark the beginning and end of a sentence. So the caption is looking good now, but there is one more thing to do. Vectorize this caption. Vectorization will map each word to a unique integer, as we all know neural networks can only deal with numbers. So yeah, we are done. This was the entire pre-processing pipeline. By now we can pre-process all our data, and by using TensorFlow datasets we will batch it. And by doing that, all data is ready for training. But unfortunately, I am not going through every line of code in this video, but for those who want to make this and train the model with me, all of the notebooks used in this video are linked in the description, and if you get stuck anywhere, simply leave a comment and I will help you out. So our data was training ready. The only thing remaining is to write the model architecture, the encoder, the attention mechanism, and the decoder. Putting this all together in a training loop, I started the training. The training is slow, but the loss is decreasing, so I don't mind. The training is complete now, and I have also plotted the loss curve, and you can see it is nice and decreasing. The loss would have still decreased if we had trained the model for some more epochs, but let it be. To generate the caption for new images, we need to write an inference function. Unlike training, we don't have any captions during inference. So we will give the start special token to the RNN, and at each time step, it will predict the next word, and this will repeat until end special token is predicted. I've done the same thing in the evaluate function, so let's put our model to the test. Every time I run this cell, it will pick a random image from the data frame and generate a caption for it. Let's learn the cell. The real caption of this image is, "The toddler is splashing water in the tub with suds all over," and the predicted caption is, "A boy is covered into water." So it is very different from the actual caption, but it almost covers the meaning of the image, so I will give it 1 point for that. Next image. You can read the real caption, but the predicted caption is, "A dog runs along a narrow bridge," and showing what? And the dog is not even running, so this was rubbish. But it has identified that there's a dog in this image, which is a good thing. A dog at a rocky shore. So close. The caption is perfect. It's just not identified that there's a man with a dog as well. I think we should forgive it for this one. A little boy is sitting in behind a fence. There's no fence here. Three children standing on the rocks of a rocky river. It has repeated the word rock 2 times, but it's okay. A child is trying to play with a boy in green hair painted with doldy face. The caption was almost related to the image at first, but it completely messed up the ending part. And similarly, I did this for 18 images and it was right, or I should say almost right, 45% of the time. However, some of the captions made no logical sense at all. This was good, but I wanted to do something even better, and that's when I decided to click on the next link on the Google search page. This time it was a tutorial by Keras.io. I hope that they would use some different method than TensorFlow's, and my mind was blown by seeing that they used the transformer. And the best part is that we just need to make two changes to our model architecture to use the transformer. The first change will be to replace this fully connected layer with a transformer encoder. Because there is self-attention in the transformer encoder, this will result in even higher quality feature vectors of the image. The second modification will be to replace the RNN and attention mechanism with the transformer decoder. We are removing the attention mechanism because the transformer already has attention built in, so we don't need to do it explicitly. The explanation of how transformer works is beyond the scope of this video, but I will include links to some of the best transformer tutorials in the description, so you can check them out. Before I show you the results of this architecture, I want you to know that I trained this transformer architecture with two datasets before I even started to make this video. The first was our Flickr 8K dataset, which we already used, but the captions the transformer generated were good but very redundant and boring. For example, if I give it any image with a dog in it, it always generated a dog running in the field. For some reason, it was playing it safe and was not being creative at all. That's when I decided to train the transformer again, but this time with the COCO dataset. If you are thinking that's too much work, I only changed about 10 lines of code to make this shift, and all the pre-processing step remains exactly the same. Let's see the results. On the left is the caption generated by the RNN architecture, while on the right is the transformer architecture. All of the images you will see are chosen at random from the internet in order for the comparison to be fair. Only after a few examples you can see that the captions generated by the transformer are of very high quality compared to RNN. Sometimes the RNN outputs complete gibberish, but the transformer stays on point even though these images are completely new to both of them. But it's not the transformer is always correct. It too makes some mistakes, such as here where it generated large mountains two times, which is completely illogical. However, I'm happy with the transformer's performance. It far exceeded my expectation, and the best thing is that I only trained it on a fraction of the COCO dataset. I wonder how well it would perform if we trained it on the entire dataset. But I wanted anyone to be able to use this without having to see a single line of code. That's when I decided to use Streamlit to deploy this on a web interface. The first thing I did after the training ended was to save the model widths, so we could load our model in the Streamlit environment to generate the captions. Because Streamlit is so simple to use, I was able to create an excellent web app in less than an hour. This is what the final interface looks like. You can either enter an image URL from the web or choose an image from your PC. Simply click this button and select any image, wait for a while, and the generated captions are back. Simple as that. I have also put this on HuggingFace, which you can access via this URL. So have fun with it.